turn our Bibles to 2 Timothy in chapter 4 and verses 6 to 8. 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verses 6 to 8. Would somebody read it for us?
For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Amen.
This is almost like the epitaph of Apostle Paul, what he would probably put on his tombstone. You know, what is he saying? I'm already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time has come for my departure. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Now this is a verse that is read and quoted and prayed at don't get scared. But the point is that Apostle Paul is able to clearly say with absolute confidence that he has finished well. He has finished well. Now, of course, he's talking about the finishing of the end of his life, the end of his ministry. You know, he's talking about that finishing line that he is crossing over, and it's time for his departure, and he's very certain that he's going to leave this world. He's done God's purpose and God's plan in his life. He's finished the task. He's kept the faith. He's finishing well. Now, we are almost at the end of a year. We're going to be finishing a year, moving into another new year. It's just less than a month ahead of us, a few weeks before we move on into another new year. And this time where we are finishing a year, I think it's good for us to look back and see how the year has been, how our lives have been. Not just that. Are we finishing well? The goal for us, not just for this year, but also for our lives, is to finish well. Not just to finish. Everybody will finish. Everybody has a finish line. But the point is, can we be able to say like the Apostle Paul at the end of the road, that I fought a good fight, I finished the race, I have kept the faith. And with absolute confidence, he says, now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. There is a reward for the finishing well as well. It's not just to run and to finish well, and with that the story is not over. But there is a reward for the finishing well. And it's important for us to look at how it's important to finish well. At this point where we are going to be finishing this year, we begin to reflect on our own lives and see, have we fared well so that we can say, I will finish well. If we have not fared well, it's impossible to finish well. And how we fare through the year makes it absolutely confident for us to say, I'm finishing this year very well. And the desire of God for us is that we will finish well. The plan of God for us is that we will finish well. God intends, God desires that you will finish well. It's important for us that we fare well, not bidding farewell, but we are faring very well so that we will finish well. And also come with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. You see, this was very much in the heart of the Apostle Paul. is not just a stray statement towards the end of his life and ministry, but also in 1 Corinthians, and look at chapter 9 and verses 24 to 27. Do you not know that in a race, all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? 1 Corinthians 9, 24 to 27. In a race, all the runners run, but only one gets the prize. Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last. But we do it to get a crown that will last forever. You see that crown of righteousness he talked about, the reward, the award that he talked about in 2 Timothy chapter 4. Very similar thing. Speaking here, talking about the race. There also he talked about, I have fought a good fight. I have run the race. I finished the race. Here again, talking about the race, the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Verse 26, therefore, I do not run like a man running aimlessly. I do not fight like a man beating the air. You see again, the running, the fighting. 2 Timothy 4 again. Same lines. I've fought a good fight. We do not fight like a man beating the air. No, I beat my body and make it my slave so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. That after I have led others, after I have preached to others, that I myself will not be disqualified for the prize again. Finishing well. The desire to finish well. Our eyes must be fixed on our goal. Sometimes people move the goalposts. It's a get to score well because they've shifted their goalposts. We are not supposed to shift the goalposts. But the goal is to become like Christ. The goal is to finish well. And as we aim for it, we proceed in that direction, subjecting our sinful nature. As he says, I beat my body and make it my slave so that after I preach to others. So overcoming the sinful nature, overcoming the hurdles that would prevent us from finishing well, putting ourselves into good discipline. And as he says there, everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. We're going through training as we're reading the Word of God, as we're studying the Word of God, as we're learning the truths of Scripture, and as we begin to apply them in our lives and live them out and put them into practice. What we do is to put ourselves into strict training so that we will run well. We might face hurdles. We might face ups and downs. We might pass through all kinds of things, but yet ultimately that we will fare well and finish very well and get the prize. Many runners run. Everybody begin the race. The moment the gunshot is heard, everybody who is in the race, you know, have taken their positions and they've been ready, made themselves ready. They've been through practice and all of that. But yet, once the shot is, heard, the next moment everybody is on their feet. And they're in the race. Some fall by the wayside. Some give up because they don't have the will to carry on. Some fumble and fall because they're physically not fit enough to compete with the other runners because they've not put enough training. They've not gone for the practices. They've not been there in the field early in the morning at 5:30, 6 o'clock, early in the morning. They've not submitted to the coach. The coach said, do 10 rounds, warm up and come back. They probably did 5. They did it slowly and they joined the others who came around. Maybe they did so many things where, they did not make themselves fit enough to be able to withstand the pressure, and the needed the strength was not sufficient to run the race and to finish it. And so they maybe pulled a nerve or injured their feet, twisted their ankle. Something went wrong along the way that they could not finish. They could not even reach the finish line, leave alone finishing well. And so it's important for us to consider this morning, as to how we are doing in our lives for us to finish well, that we will have our goal set. We will have this imprinted in our hearts very strongly, that it's important that whatever be my age, whatever be the stage you are at in your life, that our goal will be to finish well. Not only in finishing well long term in our lives, and we might say, oh, we have a lot of time. It's okay if things are not fine with me now, but someday I'll get better, and someday I will move on, and I will, you know, build my life, and I will somehow, I'm sure that I'm going to finish well. But the reality is, if we don't finish well each day, we will never finish well on the final day. If we don't finish well each day, we will never be able to finish well on the final day. Because you never know when the last day will come. I'm not trying to scare us, but this is the reality of life. We see that life is taken away, stolen away, for many people at different times, or at any time in life. It's totally unpredictable. Our lives are so fragile. The breath that we have in our nostrils are so fragile that if you take the next breath, that's just the grace of God. And we know a lot of them who have finished their race just recently. We had a lot of holidays. We do not know how many of them finished well. At least three important personalities left this world, which flashed on the newspapers and the TV screens. But we do not know how they finished. It's a big question mark. Talking about finishing well, even short term, is very important on a daily basis, on a monthly basis, on a yearly basis. At the end of this year, can we look back and say, I'm going to finish this year very well. Compared to the many years that have gone by, I've really been very well. Can we say that? Or is it hard to spell it out? Most importantly, in our spiritual lives, in our relationship with God, in the choices of our lives, in the things that we have prioritized, how are we faring? Are we doing well? The Bible talks about Nehemiah finishing well in 52 days, built the walls of Jerusalem, rebuilt, restored the walls of Jerusalem. I'm sure he would definitely be able to say in the words of the Apostle Paul and say, I have finished well. The purpose that God had for me, I had completed the task, the assignment that God gave me. Look at his life. He prayed, he fasted. He sought the face of the Lord. He had favor in the eyes of God. He favored favor in the eyes of the king. Favor with people. People stood by him. He was able to lead and complete the task of rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem. Of course, he had Sanballat and Tobias who came and tormented him, troubled him, intimidated him, threatened him, set a trap for him. They did all kinds of things, Sanballat and Tobiah, but they were not able to overcome Nehemiah. He fought the fight, went through the hurdles, went through the hardships, went through the challenges, prayed, stood his ground, was alert. The people stood with one hand, they had the sword, and another hand they did the work. held the fort, didn't miss the opportunity, fasted, prayed, struggled through, and victoriously finished it. Hallelujah. That's how a Christian life is. We go through challenges, we go through temptations, we go through trials, we go through needs. We have questions, we have unanswered prayers. We face all of these things, but yet through it all we push. And with faith in God, with trust in God, knowing that He works all things for our good, we set our eyes upon the goal and we run this race to finish well. Look at the quality of life that Nehemiah lived. The quality of life that all the apostles lived. It all goes back into their personal relationship with God for them to finish well. They were very close to God. They had God with them. God was on their side. Statistics say that it's not very encouraging that 2/3 of those who begin their walk with God don't finish well. That's a very rough statistic. It's hard to verify that. That's what I found. It's even true of Bible colleges. That everybody who passes out really don't finish well. That can be the state of those who are trained, who are called, who are anointed, who are trained. 3 years, 5 years. They don't really finish well. About 30-40% don't finish. And so it's important for us to consider this at the end of this year. Will I be able to say that I'm finishing well? It's important that we look back into our own lives. And Jesus was asking some very strategic questions. Thought-provoking, strong questions. In those lines, if you turn in your Bibles along with me to Matthew's Gospel chapter 16 and look at verses 24 to 28. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will find it." If we look at gaining in this life, we will lose what is of eternal value. That's what he means. Verse 26, "What good will it be for a man if he gains the whole world yet forfeits his soul? What good will it be for a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? What good will it be if we amass wealth and if we have all the material possessions of this life? And if we gain much for this world and in this world and the things of this world, the name, the fame, the glory, the money, the possessions, after we gain everything, what good it is if we lose our soul?" So ultimately the question of how are we going to finish? What is going to be the end of it? What would be the greatest thing that would really matter at the end of it all? A person has been a child of God. A person has given his or her life to Jesus. That person can surely say, "I will be with Jesus eternally. I finished well." But if we have gained much in this world, but if we have lost everything. The story of the rich man and Lazarus is a good example of that. The poor man did not have anything in this world, but found his place at the bosom of Abraham. But the rich man was tormented in hell. He had much in this life, but ultimately, with all that he seemed to have in terms of success, in terms of achievements, in terms of all that he needed for life, what was the end of it? He couldn't spend his eternity with Jesus. He couldn't spend his eternity in heaven. And so it's important for us to really consider of what is of greater value, what should be prioritized in life, what should be central to our lives. We must ask ourselves that question. What is important for me? What are those things that really matter for me? What are those things that I really want to prioritize? Is it God? Is it the things of God? Or are they the things of this world? It is an eternal loss for those who forfeit their soul, even if they gain much in this life. But God will reward each man according to his deeds. And that's what it says here as well, verse 27. For the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels. And then he will reward each person according to what he has done. At the end of each financial year, 31st March, you have what is called as the closing of the accounts. And then everything is audited and then filed with the tax departments, filed returns. It's audited. Your year's income and expenditures are audited to see if you have done well. That gives you a clear picture of where you stand financially. Is the graph going up or is it going down? Have you done well? Have you done good business? Have you earned good money? Have you had good profits? Or is it just at a break-even level or is it going down? It's audited. It's checked. 2 Corinthians in chapter number 5 and verse number 10. 2 Corinthians 5:10 says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive what is due him for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. We will all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. There's a day of audit that we will have to appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive what is due him for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. Some people bring this teaching which says, after you are saved, after you are baptized, your spirit is made perfect and whatever you do in your body does not affect your soul. What an incorrect teaching it is. That's a deception. That gives a license to sin. That leads into licentious living. Look at it. It says, whatever done in the body, whether good or bad, we will have to give an account. Also in Romans in chapter 14. Romans 14. And look at verse number 12. So then each of us will give an account of himself to God. Will give an account of himself. We can't use somebody else's accounts and say we fared well. My father gave for the missions. He helped so many missionaries in North India. My mother did a lot of charity to the poor people in the neighborhood. We can't use somebody else's accounts. Each of us will have to give an account. My wife prayed very much. She's a prayer warrior. She even prayed in Jesus Christ's prayer tower. I was a young partner. I used to pay regularly. I even got the magazine. I used to go to church regularly. It's good. But it's not just in the superficial things, the external things, or what others have done. We used to be the pillar of the church. In fact, we were even in the cross sections and the beams. That does not give us the qualification to say that we finish well. Amen. Hallelujah. Are you with me this morning? Praise the Lord. At the end of our lives, may we have a glorious end. It's not so important as to how we began. It's so much more important as to how we finish. Hallelujah. Some people began well but didn't finish well. You have so many stories of great biblical characters, even in scriptures as we read, of those who began well. Look at the life of Samson. Wonderful example. Glorious beginning. An angel comes and says of his birth, he's called a Nazarene. He's given extraordinary strength. He's been called to be the judge over Israel. He judged Israel for 20 years. But then look at his end. Look at him. Would he have been able to say, like Apostle Paul, that I have finished well? And so it's not so important as to how we start, but how we are faring now, how we will finish. We're going to take stock of our lives this morning. But before that, one example I'm going to give of one who finished well and one who did not finish well. We also have many contemporary stories. And I'm not going to give us names, but you all know. Even today, in the world outside, the people who were involved in ministry, the people who did have a great life, who had a great beginning, didn't seem to. But the one person for sure who finished extremely well is Jesus himself. There's no greater example than Jesus who finished well. Of course, it doesn't mean that Jesus' life is totally over. You know that he rose again from the dead and he ascended back into heaven. But his life on this earth, in his humanness. Look at John's Gospel in chapter 17 and verse number 4. John's Gospel, chapter number 17. And verse 4. Before Jesus got arrested, because before he was going to go through the suffering on the cross, he says, as he prays to the Father, he says in John 17:4, I have brought you glory on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. Father, I have completed the work that you gave me. I have finished well. Of course, on the cross he said it is finished. But of course, that's more in the context of finishing the task of redemption, the work of redemption for which he came. But here Jesus is talking about his life on the earth, the ministry. His life and ministry. The work of redemption is going to happen in a little while. But here in his life and ministry, he says, I finished the task for which I came. In John 5, he talks about the work the Father has given to him to finish. In John 5 and verse 36, I have testimony weightier than that of John, for the very work that the Father has given me to finish and which I am doing testifies that the Father has sent me. The work that I am doing, which the Father has commissioned me to finish, that testifies that the Father has sent me. See, he was boldly able to say through the course of his life that I am faring well. I am doing the work that the Father has given me to finish. And that testifies to the fact that the Father has sent me. The way I live, what I do, how I live, everything works toward finishing the work that the Father has given me. And the work that I am doing is testifying that the Father has sent me. He's been faring well. And even through the course of his life, he was in between able to boldly say, I'm doing the task. And my task itself testifies. I'm going to finish it. There's a work that the Father has given me, and I'm doing it. He was able to confidently say, I'm doing the task the Father has given me. I'm living my life the way the Father wanted me to live. I'm doing the will of the Father. Very often he would say, I say what I hear, I do what he says. He was boldly able to say that. He finished well, not just by doing the finishing well of doing the work of redemption on the cross, by dying on the cross, but his life and ministry. Remember, Jesus was truly human, perfectly human while he was on this earth. Of course, perfectly, truly divine as well. But let's not forget the fact of his humanity, the reality of his humanity. Just like you and I. That's what the Bible clearly says, that he was human like you and I. Turn with me to Hebrews in chapter number 5. Being in his humanity, he proved himself to finish well. The Bible says that he was made perfect. In Hebrews chapter 5, read from verses 1 onwards. Every high priest is selected from among men and is appointed to represent them in matters related to God to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. So basically, the work of a priest is to represent men before God, offer sacrifices. Verse 2, he is able to deal gently with those who are ignorant and are going astray, since he himself is subject to weakness. That is why he has to offer sacrifices for his own sins as well as for the sins of people. No one takes his honor upon himself. He must be called by God just as Aaron was. So Christ also did not take upon himself the glory of becoming high priest. You see, just as any normal human high priest was with sin, and so he had to offer sacrifices for his sin also because he himself was weak. He failed. And so he had to offer sacrifices for his sin, and then he would offer sacrifices representing the people. And so in the same way, Jesus also did that. He did not take upon himself the right or to say that he was perfect. He did not take upon himself the glory of becoming a high priest. He did not take it as a right. He did not say, oh, I am God, I am divine, I am a high priest by right, by virtue of birth, I am perfect, and so here I come as a high priest. Listen to me carefully. He did not say, I am of divine birth, I am divine, and so by virtue of my birth, I am perfect. And so I take upon myself this role of high priest. He did not assume himself to be perfect. That's what it says in verse 5. So Christ also did not take upon himself the glory of becoming a high priest. By stature, by virtue of birth, he did not take upon himself, assume that he was perfect and worthy to be high priest. He did not assume that. But come down to verse 7. During the days of Jesus' life on earth. Verse 7. He offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. He was heard because of his reverent submission. He offered up tears, prayers, loud cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. Obviously, here it's not talking about physical death. He's going to die. He came to die. The one who could save him from spiritual death. He offered up cries and prayers to God who could save him from spiritual death. He was heard because of his reverent submission. As he prayed, as he cried out to God, as he fellowshiped with God. You know, very often it would say, scriptures say, gospels say that Jesus withdrew from the crowds. Very often scriptures say Jesus went all alone. He went away from the disciples. He went away from the people. He went away to pray to the Father. He cried out to God every day. There was no need for him to cry and pray. He was God. But yet, because he was in his humanity and he was had the same weaknesses and prone to weaknesses, because in humanity was his frailty, he needed the strength of God to save him from spiritual death. Do you understand that? We normally have a picture of Jesus who is perfect. Yes, he is perfect. He is perfect. As if to say that he is not prone any weakness at all, but he was in his humanity. Let's not forget the reality of that humanity as well. that he prayed, he cried out to God. And although he was a son, verse 8, he learned obedience from what he suffered. He learned obedience. Bible talks about Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. He increased, he needed favor. Favor of God, favor with man. By what he suffered, he learned obedience and once made perfect, proven to be perfect. Hallelujah. You see here, going through the suffering, going through the process of learning obedience, going through the process of reverently submitting by praying to God, receiving strength in the inner man by the temptations he faced. Yesterday I asked a question which made many people very uncomfortable in fasting prayer. As Jesus was in his humanity, do you think he was attracted to a good-looking person next door, a girl next door? Some people, it sounded like blasphemy. Who could even think something like that? I didn't ask if he lusted. I didn't ask if he gave in to the temptation. I asked if he was facing a temptation. Do you think he was tempted?
Yes.
Verse 4 and 15. Chapter 4 and verse 15 says that. Chapter 4 verse 15. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses. But we have one who has been tempted in every way. Tempted in every way just as we are. Yet was. It immediately adds to that. Yet was without sin. You see, so he faced the temptations. Many people think Jesus only had 3 temptations. Matthew 4. But he was tempted in every way. He was as really human as you are. But yet was able to overcome every one of them because of his reverent submission as he learned to. Hallelujah. And once made perfect, proven to be perfect. How can you say something is perfect unless you test that it is perfect? And so he went through the trial, he went through the temptation, he went through the testing and was proven to be perfect. And now he's ready. Verse 9. 5:9, he became the source of eternal, and once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey. He was ready to be the lamb to be sacrificed for sins. He was the high priest himself who sacrificed, and he was also the sacrificial lamb himself. He played a dual role. He was both the high priest who was sacrificing and the lamb who was sacrificed also. Because he was not killed on the cross. He was not assassinated. He offered himself to die. Offered this himself as a sacrifice unto God. And so you see Jesus talks about his human life finishing well. Amen. Jesus is our greatest example. What I want us to see is that Jesus did not automatically or by some kind of virtue of birth remain just perfect, undisturbed with anything of this world and the sinfulness of this world. No. He was as human as you and I are, but yet finished well, was made perfect, proven to be perfect. So it's important that we also strive to be like Jesus. But one of the key things is that he was submitting himself to through praying, submitting himself to God through praying, loud cries and prayers. I always wondered until very recently, until I really read and understood this passage of scripture, I always wondered, why did Jesus pray with loud cries and tears? Why did he have to cry and loud? Whatever he asked the Father would do. He was the Son of God. Why did he have to loudly cry and pray? He needed strength in the inner man. He needed strength every day. He needed to face the temptations. He needed to overcome the hurdles of life. He had to go through suffering. He was rejected. He was dejected. He was thrown away. He was not accepted. He went through everything. People didn't understand him. People misunderstood him. Everything that happens to anybody happened to Jesus. But because of his loud cries and prayers, he was saved from a spiritual death. And he was made perfect, proven to be perfect. So Christ did not take upon himself the right of high priest just by virtue of birth, the glory just by virtue, but he went through the process. He went through the struggle. He went through the suffering. I'm not talking about the suffering that he had on the cross for the salvation of mankind. I'm talking about his life, the human life that he lived. He went through the trials. He went through the temptations. He faced sufferings in life. He faced the challenges of life. But he was praying loud cries and prayer. That is what is going to give us the strength to finish well. Hallelujah. If we really want to strive to finish well, it's important that we pray and be strengthened in the inner man. Yes, of course, this is a simple idea of prayer. I pray every day. I'm not just talking about praying in the morning when we go to work. Jesus, bless me, bless my wife, bless my spouse, my mouse, my pussycat, and my doggy. I'm not talking about that prayer. I'm talking about receiving the strength to overcome every day and to finish well. That's why when John, the apostle of Jesus, received the revelation to the seven churches, at end of every, message to the churches, he finishes by saying, to him who overcomes, to him who overcomes, to him who finishes well. He was tempted, he faced challenges, but he came unscathed. That is to finish well. There was nothing that was wrong with him. Nobody could point a finger at him. Nobody could accuse him. Pilate himself said, I don't find any reason for him to be put to death. But on the other side, Philemon, verse 24. Turn with me to Philemon, verse 24. One page before Hebrews, verse 24. Talking about Demas. Verse 24, look at who Demas was. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, send you greetings. And verse 24, and so to Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers. Demas was a fellow worker with Paul. Demas, a fellow worker. So while signing off, Paul is saying, oh, Demas was also a fellow worker. We all send you greetings. May the grace of Jesus Christ be with your spirit. But come with me to 2 Timothy and chapter 4. The same chapter where we began. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 9 and 10. Do your best to come to me quickly, for Demas, because he loved this world, has deserted me and has gone to Thessalonica. Crescens has also gone to Galatia and Titus to Dalmatia. Do your best to come quickly, Timothy, for Demas, because of the love of this world, has deserted me and has gone to Thessalonica. Demas, have you finished well? Anybody wants to name their kids as Demas? Nobody likes to do that. Because Demas did not finish well. He deserted Apostle Paul and he went to Thessalonica. That's interesting. Why? Now, you look at it. You see, our text this morning was 6 to 8, isn't it? Paul writing about himself and saying he's finishing well. Immediately the next verse talks about Demas saying, he deserted me. He did not finish well. You see, there's a contrast there. It's interesting that the scripture records of Demas going to Thessalonica. Why Thessalonica? Well, there's something about Thessalonica. course, Paul had planted a church there. He had evangelized. That's why you have the letters of Paul writing to the church at Thessalonica. You read Acts chapter 16, 18, 20, all of those places, many places you will find the references to Thessalonica. But its location, Thessalonica also contributed to probably one of the reasons why Demas left Paul. Because it was probably one of the greatest cities of the then-known world, in the Roman world. An important key city, a military highway, which connected Rome and the East. It ran through Macedonia and was a parallel to the Aegean Sea. It had a sheltered harbor, which was made into a naval station equipped with docks by the Romans. Now, this was a very key place where it was a port city. It was, it had commercial activity, had two important things. It made the Thessalonians very wealthy. It was a wealthy city. Well-to-do Romans settled there. And Jewish merchants were attracted because of the commercial advantages of the city. And so even Jews came and settled down in Thessalonica. The majority of people made their living by labor. Macedonian women enjoyed a higher social position. You know, those days women were very subjected and they were treated like subhuman beings. They did not have good social status, but in Thessalonica, women had very good social positions and greater privileges than elsewhere in the then-known civilized world. And secondly, Thessalonica also was known for its evil sin and licentiousness. The strange mixture of seaport, business, commercial activity, social status of women, high social status of women, and sin prevalent in the world. These were the things that were there. Maybe a wild thinking like this, a holy assumption I'd like to make. Maybe Demas wanted to settle there because he'll get good education for his children. Sometimes you think, oh, Demas fell into sin. There's no record of love of this world. It can be anything. Maybe a social security. If you go around with this man, Paul, you have to be going place to place. You will not know where the Spirit will lead him to go next, the next place. You will not know where, you know, there will be a shipwreck and then you will have to swim your way to the shore. But let's settle down. It's enough of all this traveling. It's time it's already 40. I'm crossing 40 and it's time for me to get things settled for my family and my children, good education, and it's a safe place for my wife, and she has a good, she can be a good entrepreneur here. She can probably get into some activism. Maybe some ideas like that. I don't know. Maybe you found some good schools and colleges. Maybe there was better internet connectivity there. Love of this world. Demas deserted Paul and the ministry for the love of this world. It can be anything. Didn't finish well. So it's important for us to consider this morning. As we're going to come to the close of this year in a few more weeks, can we examine our own personal lives? Evaluate ourselves by ourselves. I'm not asking somebody else to evaluate you, but I'm asking if can you evaluate yourself in the light of all that we've been hearing. Jesus finishing well, Demas. Of course, there are many, many examples we can go through. We don't have time now, but I will close with that.